questions that that has been, I think, at the top of mind for many investigators is selection of first line therapy in metastatic pancreatic cancer patients. We all know there was the MPACT study comparing gemabraxane versus gem monotherapy, and the doublet was more favorable. We're also aware there was the FOLFIRINOX study comparing FOLFIRINOX versus gem monotherapy, and again, FOLFIRINOX was superior. But there really hasn't been a head-to-head comparison evaluating which of the multi-agent chemotherapy regimens are superior. So there really is no direct comparison looking at FOLFIRINOX versus gemabraxane. So because of that, I've taken a keen interest on real-world evidence studies. You know, what are people doing in real life? So with that in mind, our group in Canada, we merged data across several provinces and looked at what we're doing. You know, are we choosing gemabraxane more or FOLFIRINOX more or gem monotherapy more? And what we found there was that it was lower use of gem monotherapy, but roughly equal use of gemabraxane and FOLFIRINOX. Interestingly, regardless of what they use in the first-line setting, the outcomes are pretty similar. And among those who got the multi-agent chemotherapy, those who then proceeded to second-line therapy obviously did better as well. We looked at sequencing, too, in our analysis. And again, whether you start with FOLFIRINOX and get another agent after, or whether you start with gemabraxane and get another agent afterwards, again, outcomes were pretty similar. So our conclusions there was were that, you know, I think patient selection is very important. And if we're choosing patients carefully for the right regimen, really, it doesn't matter that much which regimen you're using. And there's benefit to both approaches. It was interesting to see a similar study done in Korea. The primary author was Huang, and he found something very, very similar. A similar cohort size, about 300 or 500 patients, actually. And again, looking at choice of first-line therapy, he did find those who were a little older were more highly chosen for gemabraxane as opposed to FOLFIRINOX. But again, the outcomes or survival curves were overlapping again. In the overall cohort, whether you gave FOLFIRINOX or gemabraxane, outcomes were no different. And in fact, there were certain subgroups that showed that if you were older, you actually did better with gemabraxane. So that was kind of interesting to see as well. So that was quite informative, I think. And again, it tells me that there really is no perfect regimen in the first line setting. And based on the patient sitting in front of you, you have to choose the best regimen for them. One of the drawbacks of real-world evidence studies is that they are retrospective usually. They're not prospective. So typically, toxicity profiles are not reliably captured. So in both the Canadian study and the Korean study, it was really looking at efficacy and outcomes and a comparison of the two regimens. None of the toxicity or side effects were really shared. Clinical trials are still the gold standard for testing the efficacy of new drugs and new regimens. But having said that, studies have shown over and over again that trial participants are very different from real-world patients. And among trial participants, if you look at kind of their phenotype or their ECOG status, they probably represent 10% of real-world patients. So trials are gold standard, they're randomized and they're controlled, but it's the external validity or the generalizability is very low. So again, I think for testing efficacy, trials are still the convention, and that should be the way to go. But I think it does behoove us to look at, well, what happens to the 90% of individuals who can't participate in trials, and what are their outcomes? So I actually don't see them as kind of competing. They're kind of synergistic. So trials had its place to look at, you know, really fit individuals, and then real-world studies really complement that by looking at those who are less fit and older. In both the MPAC and LAPAC study, for example, the vast majority of individuals were ECOG zero. In real life, that's totally not the case. The vast majority are not ECOG zero. They're actually ECOG one and two. So again, the question now becomes, well, can we ensure that the benefits seen in the trials can be replicated in those who are not the same individuals? So that's where I think real-world studies fit in. More and more now, I think even trialists value real-world research because they realize, you know what, we have to look at both types of studies and look at the, I guess, the happy medium or the compromise between the two.